Good day, everyone. I'm Alan Preston.
Hi, everybody. I'm Annette Watkins, and this is Cooking Without Looking.
We are the first TV show which features people who are blind and visually impaired.
And we have something special today. We're going to go down south. And I don't mean Mississippi. I mean the southernmost island country of Trinidad and Tobago.
That sounds great to me. And we're going to meet Bhawani Persad. He's the president of the Persons Associated with Visual Impairment.
Yeah, and even more delightful, equally delightful, is we have two guests from Trinidad and Tobago. We have Ramchara, and we have Thora Small. They're going to prepare their favorite dishes for us today.
Well, Annette, I hear you are preparing some avocado pasta. That sounds good.
Yes, I'm so excited to share that with you today. And just a reminder, I would like to tell you that everybody on the Cooking Without Looking show is either blind or visually impaired. I have a disease called Sjögren's disease, which is a form of macular degeneration.
Well, let's begin with our virtual culinary tour and visit of Trinidad and Tobago on the Cooking Without Looking TV show.
Yay, so excited. Officially, the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago consists of the main islands and many other little islands. Like for instance, Trinidad is about 1,000 square miles. Tobago, if I get this correctly, is about 115 square miles. So it has a variety of different sizes of islands. But what they're known for is their fossil fuel wealth. But even more exciting, what people seem to be very interested in, the fact that Trinidad and Tobago consists of cultures from Africa and the cultures are reflected in the very famous carnival, Diwali, the Festival of Lights, and also Jose. And they have influences of music, the birthplace of the steel pan and limbo and music styles like calypso and so on. So, guys ready? I hope so, because I'm going to be introducing our first guest. And her name is Thora Small. Hi, Thora. How are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Good. It's great to have you here. I understand you're going to prepare for us a delicious corn dish. It's very hearty and heavy and delicious.
Corn meal.
Oh, Coo Coo. Did I say that correctly?
Yeah, Coo Coo.
Okay, great. Before we get started on your dish, Thora, I'd like you, please, if you would share with us your blindness journey, a little bit what you do in Trinidad, and a little bit more about you.
Well, I'm a Tobagonian.
Okay.
From birth, I was visually impaired. I went to the school for blind in Trinidad in Santa Cruz. And then I worked at Blind Welfare Association in Tobago.
Tell us about how you became blind, when you became blind, a little bit more about your eye condition, if you would, please.
From birth, I was blind, visually impaired, in fact, because I have some sight still.
Okay, is there a name for the condition, or if they didn't know? Is there a name for that condition, Thora?
Just cornmeal cuckoo.
You
that is the name of the dish.
Okay.
And the ingredients are coconut milk, okra, pimentos, and carrots.
That's delicious. I can't wait. So why don't you go ahead and prepare your dish and tell us some things as you go along. I'm very curious about this okra.
But I have the pimentos, the okras, and the carrots in the coconut milk boiling on the stove. So I am putting in some cornmeal in some cold water. I'm stirring it.
Excuse me one moment, Thora. For some reason, I don't have any video at all. I don't know if you guys can see me, but I can't see anybody.
This is grated corn.
Thora, small way.
This what I have here is grated corn. Right? And it became right, and then I am throwing it into the pot and stirring it.
Okay, I can see you now. Okay, so you're cooking your cornmeal first. Is that what you're doing?
Yes, it is. This is how it looks. You have to be stirring it.
You know, I was watching some videos on this, Thora, and I noticed that everybody that was making this dish really had to stir it up a lot during the whole process. Why is that?
It would not make any lump.
Oh, you want to get rid of the lumps. Okay.
Yes.
It seems like it's a good workout for your arm.
Yes.
I love cornmeal. Can't wait. I wish we could taste it. So keep going. You got your cornmeal cooking, and then what? Just keep stirring it for a while.
All right. And then you can lower your stove and cover it for about 5 minutes for the corn to properly well cook.
WhatsApp, search, out of date.
How long do you stir it for, Thora?
About 15 minutes.
Wow, okay.
Admiral Michael, Bible quiz corner.
Yes, and then for about 5 minutes, you put it, let it cover for it to properly well soak.
WhatsApp. Okay.
Message, edit box, out of.
And then you'll, right, so I put it on a low stove and I'm covering it for about 5 minutes.
Okay. I missed the beginning part. Did you add your okra yet or your peppers?
Then you grease your dish.
What's up? And cow and Austin, 11:02 a.m., AGF tones. He is, what's up? Type a message.
The grease your dish with some butter.
A message. Edit.
Thora, I'm sorry. We have to get a better connection here, honey. Did you add your okra already?
Yes. Yes.
What is that? I did not hear. Yeah.
Did you add your okra already?
Yes.
Oh, you did. Okay. Tell us why you use okra and not another vegetable. Is there a reason? Is it because of the seeds or what?
No, sometimes you don't have to use anything else.
Really?
But I just love to add okras in my dish for a little additional flavor.
Right. Disappeared again. I don't see you on the screen. What kind of peppers do you use in there, Thora?
Pimentos.
Pimentos. Are those hot or are they mild? Yes.
Pimento.
Are they hot or mild? I'm not sure.
No, it just flavors the pot.
Okay.
And you see how this is looking?
It looks delicious. It looks very hard.
Yes.
It looks very creamy.
So after this, just put it in the grease pot and leave it there to cool. Then you slice for how many people wishes to eat, because not everyone eats Coo Coo.
How did that name come about? Do you know? That's a cute name. How did that come about?
I don't know. I heard my grandmother. Okay. My grandmother, I heard the name.
Yeah. So it's a tradition. Is this a really big tradition?
I think it's from Africa.
Okay. So now they adopted it since you have such African and Indian cultures.
Turn off the stove and you throw it out on your dish. Right? And you smoothen it out.
Yes.
And you add a little touch of butter on top. And that's it.
That's hello.
It sounds so simple and delicious.
Morning.
What's fascinating to me is once it cools, right, it forms like a mold. You could slice it up.
Right, here is the butter. I put the butter and I'm smoothing it out on the cook. To make it very tasty.
Now, is it just as good the next day or is it better to eat it today?
You could eat it when it cool out now, or you could eat it, yes, the next day.
Okay, good. Like leftovers, right?
Okay, like Bhawani, leftovers. Do you want some, Bhawani?
Sure, no problem.
All right, I'll fax it to you.
All right.
He's hungry. We're all hungry after seeing that dish. Thank you. Bhawani
will quicker get it. Here, Neil.
Thank you, Thora. Is there anything else you'd like to share or tell us, even about your country? Because I don't know if I did it justice by playing some of the cultural things.
Tobago is so sweet. I call it the land of sun, sea, and sun. It's green.
Somebody's running.
Beautiful beaches.
I know it.
It has the Nile pool. You have.
We're already
guys. There are lots of.
We'll probably going home now.
A lot of beautiful things you can see in Tobago. When the borders are open and everything, you can come to Tobago. I'm inviting you all to Tobago.
Oh, I'll be there. Definitely. What's your favorite celebration? Is it Diwali? Do you like the carnival or the Hose? Which one do you usually attend?
Oh, we have a thing called Tobago Heritage. Normally will be in July, but because of COVID, we don't have it these days. Different villages in Tobago puts on old time things. Like you have the old time wedding. You have the play that was them ring a roses and those long time games.
That sounds wonderful.
Pitching of marbles and all of that.
Oh, I wonder if you already went on and came off.
You have a thing called the belly dance.
Belly dancing. Ooh.
Yes.
I like that.
Yes. And
can you do some belly dances for us, Thora?
Pardon?
Can you do some belly dances for us?
Nah, I can't remember how to do that. You do the jig, the heel and toe. I think I know about the heel and toe a little.
Yeah, just kidding. It just seems like a very beautiful country. It has a lot to offer and some wonderful food, and the people are so warm and friendly.
Yes. Especially me. You can ask Bhawani about me. Bhawani is my friend, you know.
That's awesome. So do you have anything else you'd like to share before you show us your final dish? I think I'm trying to see it here. Is it on the plate right now, or is this on the pan? It's in the plate, right? Did you plate it?
Wait, let me get a plate. And
let's put two spices.
Put in this one. Yes, now I'm moving over to the counter from the stove. Right.
Are you guys in the same time zone? What time is it there? I'm just curious.
Yes, we are in the same time zone, Trinidad and Tobago.
I see. And how many islands are there? Do you know approximately? I know the big island, but how many small islands, like thousands or hundreds?
How many?
How many? You approximately, you got a lot of small islands, right?
A lot of small islands.
A lot of small islands,
Trinidad and Tobago is a twin island state.
Wow. Well, it's a great getaway. So anytime you want to invite
me to meet and hosted by Renee Redney's
participant. Anytime you need to get away, you can come to lovely Tobago.
Thank you so much, Thora. We appreciate you being here today. Thank you for sharing. Thank you for showing us your recipe.
All right.
Bill Branch has joined the meeting.
And this is the finishing touches on the plate.
Let's see your finishing touches here.
You see, finish?
Yeah, I could see a little bit there of the finishing touch. It's very colorful. Thank you so much, Thora.
And you can serve it with kalaloo or fish, anything you need to want to eat it with, fish or kalaloo.
Okay, yeah, a lot of times I do salmon, right, tilapia, they eat it together with the fish, so that's a good side dish then, or it could be a whole meal, right?
All right.
Okay, are we done here, or do we still have more with Thora?
No.
All right. That definitely looks like something I'd like to try. I like cornbread. It sounds a lot like cornbread with some interesting additives. Well, now we'll welcome Neil Ramcharan, also a member of the People Associated with Visual Impairment of Trinidad and Tobago. Neil, thank you for being here today.
Thank you all for having me.
What can you tell us about your life with blindness?
Well, basically, I lost my sight when I was 15 years old due to a glaucoma. And from there on, I took the decision not to let my blindness keep me back. So and presently, I am married with a daughter, and I am a stay-at-home dad.
Oh, okay. So you've been living pretty much an independent, normal life, just like everybody else, right?
Just like everybody else. Doing everything like everybody else, taking care of you, taking care of my daughter, that kind of thing.
Well, that really sounds great. You sound like an inspiration for a lot of people. Now, I can't wait to see how you prepare this curry chicken. I like chicken, and I happen to like good curry chicken. So please show us how you do it, would you?
Right. So
meeting.
I have the chicken already seasoned up. Okay.
Go about seasoning it.
So the chicken, well, after washing
the chicken
and flour, I season it with salt, black pepper, garlic, onion.
I don't want to see it.
And leave it like overnight. I find when I season chicken overnight, it tastes better. All right, so I have the chicken seasoned.
Is it in a liquid base?
No. What we're going to do, we're going to do it from scratch here. So what I have some oil in the pot here already. I don't know if you all see that.
Okay.
Right, so I have some oil heating up here. And I have some onions and some hot peppers cut up in a saucer here, right?
Okay. What kind of oil do you use?
You could use any kind of oil. I use vegetable oil. Some people use coconut oil. Some people use organic, different types of oil. But I mostly use vegetable oil.
Vegetable oil, okay.
Right, so the oil is heating up here. What we have now is I'm going to add the onions and the hot peppers. Right now, the peppers, you can add how much you want. It depends on how spicy you want your chicken. I just added one because I have my daughter with me. It doesn't eat much spicy food, will be sampled. Right, so.
What kind of a curry, or what kind of a pepper is that you're putting in?
It's Scotch bonnet pepper.
I'm sorry, I didn't hear you.
Right, so I add the onion and pepper here to fry up a little bit.
Okay.
I can hear it frying.
Right. Using your ears to hear when oil is hot enough to fry properly is a good little tip, isn't it?
Yeah, so you're hearing it, right?
It looks like you're cooking over a gas stove. I much prefer gas stoves.
I prefer gas stoves. You get enough heat to cook your meats and vegetables, even finish pasta as well. So after the onion and the pepper fry up for a little bit, we're going to add the curry powder, right?
Okay. Approximately how much?
When I sent the recipe for like 4 of this teaspoon that I'm using here, so I'm going to add that. Right. So what we do now is
that 5 teaspoons I saw go in there?
No, 4.
4, I'm sorry, 4 teaspoons. I had eyesight.
Right. So what we do is we let this fry up a little bit as well. Now, some people usually add a little bit of water in this curry here. I do it sometimes I don't. I will do it today. Right, so the curry fry up a little bit. So now we're going to add the water.
Careful adding water with grease, or with oil, I mean.
Yeah. Right, so what we're going to do is let us cook for a little bit until the water dissolves and wow. The curry together with the onions and pepper becomes a pea.
That smells very good too, doesn't it? Neil, when I was, I noticed that when you were talking about cleaning your chicken, you cleaned it with lime juice. And I understand that's because of lime's high acidity. It can neutralize some dangerous bacteria found in foods, as well as having powerful and healthy effect on the immune system. Is that why you guys clean your chicken with lime juice?
The lime actually gets rid of some of the fresh smell from meat. You know, like chicken, the kind of fresh meat. You also use lime to get rid of that fresh smell from the meat as well.
Yes, it does add a nice smell too. You're absolutely right.
Actually, the curry is ready.
How can you tell when your chicken is done?
Right, so the curry is ready. Here I have my chicken, but I pre-seasoned.
Okay.
So now I'm going to add it. So we have to lower the heat a little bit on the stove. I'm filling. We mix the chicken with the curry and all the heat is coated with the curry paste.
I'm having a little difficulty hearing you clearly. I gather you're mixing that up well.
Yes.
Yes. Okay.
Right. And what you do now is just cover it and leave it to cook for a while, and then we'll come back and check it to add some more water.
Reduce the heat a little bit and just let it cook for a while.
Yeah.
So we'll about how long does it take after you get the chicken seared like that? How long does it take?
When the chicken is properly covered with the curry paste, they leave it to cook for like 4 to 5 minutes, and then you come and you just add some water to finish cook the chicken. What happens, chicken and also any kind of meat does spring water for itself when you start to cook it.
Okay. What part of the chicken?
Okay.
I actually use a whole chicken. I have thighs, wings, breast meat, you know?
Everything but the feet.
actually no. We actually do put the feet as well sometimes, you know?
Okay. Well, that really sounds good, Neil. Do you have the finished product that you can show us? Oh, I lost Neil here.
What I'm going to do is add some water. What you could also do is also add a cup of water if you desire.
Okay.
Right. So the chicken is on its way.
Okay. Do you have some finished product that you can show us?
Yeah, I'll put it on a dish and we'll see it now.
Now, Neil, this recipe will be available to us on our website at www.cookingwithoutlookingtvshow.com. Oh boy, com. Oh no, I forgot what the dot is at the
Ellen,
end.
Ellen, it's no show. It's a www.
Cooking Without Looking TV.
Right at the end. .com.
Okay.
cookingwithoutlookingtv.wordpress.com.
Thank you. It's cookingwithoutlookingtv.wordpress.com.
Right. So here we have the finished product. Let's angle the camera so you will see it.
You seeing it?
Oh, that looks delicious.
Right. So this is traditional curry chicken, but what people normally do, they could add potatoes to it, you could add peas to it, and curry the potato, the chicken with potato or with peas. And you can serve this with roti or rice.
It's the main protein dish of the meal.
Yep.
And it sounds great. I like curry chicken. I'm going to get that recipe and give that a little bit of try.
Yep, I think you
can. I can get those peppers and things up here, right? I know I can get curry here.
Yeah, I think you got, I think you could get it.
Are they available around the world?
Yeah, yeah. If you don't get like scotch bonnet pepper, you can get any other pepper that have a little spice in it. Yeah.
Okay. Well, Neil, it's been absolutely wonderful having you here with us today. And thank you very much for your time and your recipe of curry chicken.
Okay. I just like to say thanks to you all for having me and giving me the opportunity to showcase my curry chicken.
Okay. Now, did we lose Annette? Annette, are you there with us?
Can you see me? I'm here, guys.
Ah, there you are. Welcome with us, Annette. And thank you very much for being here today with us. I understand you're going to cook some avocado pasta. Is that right?
Yes. And before I do that, I just want to thank you for the opportunity. I really enjoy seeing the other chefs come on and make their specialty dishes from the southernmost country, Trinidad and Tobago. Today, we're going to be in the south as well with my dish, but it's going to be South Florida. So let me make sure you can see my food processor and my prep area. Can you see that okay in the frame, Ellen?
Yes, I do.
Okay, perfect. Yes, I'm making avocado pasta, but it's not what you, it might not be what you think. When you think of like spinach pasta, you think the alley has spinach. This doesn't have avocado in the pasta, it's just regular pasta. So the reason I chose this is because it's summer, and who doesn't like avocados? They're so versatile and so nutritious for you. So we're gonna get started. This is an easy dish. You could serve at room temperature, you could serve it hot, however you like. You could make it the day before. So let's get started. First of all, you have to use your trusty old avocado. What I'm going to do is cut this around the circumference. I don't need a real sharp knife because this avocado is soft.
Is that how you tell when they're ripe?
Yeah, you just feel it. You don't want it too mushy. Sometimes when you go to the store, they're very hard. So if you're not going to use them for a few days, that's fine. It takes a few days to ripen up. Once I cut it in half, can you see this?
I can't, but I'll bet our sighted audience can.
Right. Okay.
Well, we see it. We see it in that.
Everybody watching is visually impaired or blind, or maybe their friends or family can see it. But it's just basically I cut an avocado. I'm going to take my spoon and scoop it out and put it right in the food processor. I love this food processor. It does all the work for you, right? Makes it simple and easy. That's one half. Take out the pit now. Go. I'm going to scoop this out again. I'll tell you, this avocado is perfect because sometimes when you cut them open, they can be a little brown or a little too hard. This one's like saying, yes, I'm ready, use me. I love it.
Sit on the counter to ripen, or do you put them in a plastic paper bag or something?
Just on the counter.
And just on the counter, okay.
Yeah, and if they're kind of soft and you don't want to use them for a couple of days, put them back in the fridge. And that will they'll stunt their growth, so to speak. Okay, so we have the avocado in there. Let me just wipe my hands a little bit. I love avocado, like I said, it could be used in anything from, I make a chocolate avocado pie. Very diverse. Okay, we're gonna add about 2 tablespoons of EVOO. As Rachel Ray says, the extra virgin olive oil.
Ah, okay. I was going to ask what it's good for.
And we have some garlic that's already been peeled. This method I'm using, I just want to tell you, it's called mise en place. This has been going on since the 1800s, and it's especially good for people who are blind and visually impaired. What you do is you get all your ingredients ready before, in little cups. And then when you're ready to do your recipe, you have everything right there. You're not searching around for your items. So it's like 2 to 4 garlic cloves. We put about 4 because we like a lot of garlic. You got to have a partner that likes a lot of garlic too. Otherwise, you're in trouble.
Or no partner at all.
Yeah, or a dog, just a guide dog, maybe. But this way, you can use cheese. I'm using vegan cheese today. You could use Romana or just like a Parmesan cheese. One of my favorite ingredients, it's really more like 3 ingredients. In this bowl, I have about a cup of mixed greens, a cup of arugula mixed with spinach, and some parsley. Going to put that in. We try to sneak the greens in anytime we can.
Well, all the things got wonderful nutrients in them, right?
Oh, well, yeah, with the garlic, avocado. Avocado has like vitamin C, vitamin B, vitamin K in it. You can even put it on your face, give yourself a facial. So now, put the greens in there. Now, I don't know a lot of people who do this to put the greens in with this avocado sauce, not really a sauce, it's like a cream, real creamy sauce. But I like to sneak in the greens, especially with children. So our last ingredient is going to be lemons. Well, it smells good. Cutting in half right now. I'm going to place it in my trusty little compressor here. This is a wonderful little tool for the kitchen. And squeeze your lemon.
And that would squirt out all over the place, right?
What's that?
That way, using that means it won't squirt out all over the place.
Yeah, it's much better. Doesn't squirt in your eye or something. And then you can turn it over. I like to turn it over, make sure we get all the lemon juice.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, you have to use everything, you know? When I buy organic lemons, I put them in the freezer, and then later I make lemonade with them.
Very good.
Little bit bitter, but you gotta add the sweetener to it. You don't want to waste anything, especially when you buy organic. Okay, here's the other half. Oh, see my muscles? Go to the gym. You do this.
Well, cooking does take some muscles. I tell you what, stirring that cuckoo, that'll keep
I know. I was watching some YouTube videos on that cuckoo. I'll tell you, those people were frapping it. It's like, that's a lot of work. Okay, that's about it for the lemon. Now we'll just put the lid on the food processor. This is like a 6, it's a smaller one. This dish is enough for 2 people for skipping out tonight. All right, I'm gonna start. It'll be a little noisy, so if you wanna put your ears.
Okay. That's not too terribly noisy from this end. How long do you leave that food processor on?
You know what? You look at it and you see if it's, or you feel it. You can't see it. You put your spatula in there. If you still feel the leaves of the greens, you know you have to push them down and then start again.
Okay. It's a good tip.
Let's try to.
You just give it a few quick pulses, is that right?
I remember when I was a little girl, we lived out here. I've been here since 1973. And my dad had the biggest avocado tree in the backyard. That's all we ate. I think it's a good tree to plant if you live in Florida. You might as well, right?
Yes, they grow very well here.
Yeah. All right, I think keep going. It's not mixed yet, so we hold on. Okay.
That's interesting. There are different size food processors too, aren't there? I'm going to have to get myself one of those. Is there a particular brand that's better than another?
I'm going to smell it. I'm also going to taste it because I think I forgot to put the salt, but a lot of people don't use salt, so we'll just. Does taste good because of the cheese. The cheese is called the Italian person's salt. That's why I grew up, the Italian person's salt. Tastes pretty good. I just want to mix a little bit more because it still has some pieces of grain. If you don't mind that, I mean, you can leave it like that. That works for you.
Add a bit of a visual kind of a thing to a little pieces of grain.
Smells so good. I wish you guys could smell it. For anybody that can see, I have it here. It's getting nice and clean. Let's do one more round. And then we'll put it on our pasta and we'll garnish it.
There's no cooking at all involved with the sauce, only with the pasta. Is that right?
Even better. You can use shells, which are cubed, and the avocado goes right in there as well. And yesterday I made this and I made spaghetti, so anything works, whatever you like. I'll take the blade out and scrape it with spatula. I know I'm describing everything, but I think that's important when you have people watching that are visually impaired.
That's a very good idea. You don't lick the bowl, do you?
I do. Not today, though. I think I'll try to be more ladylike. Sometimes I lick my fingers. Skip says you shouldn't lick your fingers, but it's just too tempting. All righty. Now, one step I forgot before, I want to season this pasta a little bit. This is a mixture of garlic powder, onion powder, like a teaspoon of each, some salt and pepper. Just for the pasta, because it's real, real bland. Make sure, in addition to the cream sauce, you got some flavor in the pasta. So I added that in there. I had that all pre-measured and I put it in a little cup. Garlic powder, onion powder, and salt and pepper, just a little bit. Ooh, look at that, yum. The fun part is, I like scraping it out of there. I think it's fun, the spatula. But you're right, there's a lot in here to lick this bowl here. There's a lot of leftovers. You try to get it all.
Well, if you like avocado, a lot is a good thing.
Yes, it is. Have you ever tried my avocado chocolate pie?
No, I haven't, but it sure sounds interesting.
It does. Avocado takes on any flavor that you give it. So with avocado pie, just add cacao powder and some dates that have been soaked and softened. We add the dates in there and you have a delicious dessert. All right, I'm going to save this bowl for later when the camera's off.
Okay.
All right, I'm going to mix it now. Ooh, it's just the perfect consistency and amount. This is about 2.5 servings. I'm giving more to Skip than I would eat. I don't want too much pasta, you know what I mean? Too many carbs.
Work out a little bit more, that's all.
Oh, what do you suggest I do?
You come swimming with me. I do a mile a couple of times a week.
Oh, really? I've never been a big swimmer. I just don't like getting my hair wet. I know that sounds vain, but the chlorine.
Well, yeah, but it takes longer to dry your hair.
It does. It does.
As I recall, your hair is fairly long, if I remember right.
Yeah, it's sitting there, pulling out every night. Okay, so I mixed the avocado with the pasta. Oh, that's great, guys. Now, there's three steps for garnish that I like to use. And it hits, actually, there's four. First, we're going to put some pumpkin seeds on there. I roasted these earlier in my air fryer. So they're nice and roasted. You could use pine nuts if you want. But pumpkin seeds are a little more economical, and they have a lot of magnesium in them. And I love the pumpkin seeds. It gives it a little bit of a crunch. Everybody likes a crunch, right?
Sounds good.
What's that?
I say it sounds good.
Yeah, I wish you looked closer, Alan. You'd be fed every once a month. Once a month, we could feed you. Okay, I got to put some tomatoes. These are cherry tomatoes that I cut in half. Just going to sprinkle them on top. Before you serve them, obviously, you're going to mix it. But for now, I'm just going to do it this way so you can see.
The visual appeal.
And let's see, here we have a little Parmesan cheese. This is all optional, you know. This is just the way I like to do it. You might have a different idea. Just sprinkle a little bit of Parmesan on there, just for added flavor. So Italian salt, remember, Italian salt. And some parsley for decor. Of course, you should eat your parsley. Don't just leave it on the dish. Good for you. All right, guys, this is the finished product. It's your avocado, it's just your penne pasta with the avocado cream sauce made with greens, garlic, EVOO, and some lemon, topped with some cherry tomatoes, parsley, and some Parmesan cheese and pumpkin seeds. A lot. Very nutritious. I hope you can see, whoever can see out there, take a look at this, and I hope you'll try it. Thank you so much for having me on today.
Thank you, Annette. And that looks delicious. Something that maybe you and Skip will have to cook for me one day, huh?
Oh, for sure. And you know the best part of this whole thing today? I'm done cooking for the night. I don't have to come home and eat this. I'm going to try it. It's so good. Maybe I'll try a bite of this too. Hold on. I got to try some of this. I can't wait. He gets home at 6. I have to wait till then. That's a long time.
Oh, that's too bad. You have to reheat the pasta? Is this all cold?
What's that?
I said, can you heat the pasta?
Well, what I was saying earlier, this could be eaten at room temperature. So delicious. Now, I made it the other day with my sister, and I put it in the fridge the day before, and I took it out, and I just heated it for 30 seconds. You don't want to heat it too much because you've got your fresh greens in there, and your avocado, and you don't want to heat it too much. I don't think that's good for the food to do that.
I'm going to leave the pumpkin seeds till the last thing so they stay crispy.
Yeah, that's a good point, for sure. Leave them till the end so it stays crunchy. All right, so that's about it, guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Annette. And now, aren't you introducing Bhawani?
Yes, I am. Let me move all this away. Now, I want to introduce Bhawani Persad. He is the president for persons associated with visual impairment. I hope I got that correctly.
Now, that's correct.
Did I get that right? Okay, I was looking through your resume or your bio and it just blew me away. I couldn't believe it. So from 1974, when you were an announcer in a department store, I love that. I wish you'd give us a sample of that. to the present, you've done so much. You've been a reporter. You've been a reporter, you've been a producer, a presenter, you've done so much. I would just like to welcome you here, and I just feel honored that you're here today. Can you tell us a little bit about your blindness journey and then highlight some of the things you'd like us to know up until the present, what you're doing now for the blind and visually impaired?
Okay, well, basically, I was born with a problem in the eye. Apparently, when I was born, they were saying that something was growing over the eye. Whatever it was, in those days, when you cast your mind over 60 years, you know, doctors' diagnostic wasn't as nice as it is today, so that, you know, they just treated the eye, and unfortunately, you know, whatever little sight was there, I lost it after a while. But technically, I could say I was born blind. Like Thora, like Neil, I attended the School for Blind Children at Santa Cruz here in Trinidad and Tobago from age 6 to about age 16. The school at that time was basically a primary school where we learned the basic, you know, to read, write, and even doing some chores around the building, because the school was a residential school. So we had to learn to make up our beds and wash the dishes to prepare us for the world outside there when we leave school, and you know, that kind of thing. So we got an all-rounded treat of education, which is academics plus vocational, to allow us to deal with the outside world when we became men and women, so to speak. I left school at the age of 16, a little over 16, and began working immediately, as I said, as a announcer at a departmental store, encouraging people to come in and get the bargains from the store, etc. And then it so happened that the owner of the store was a relative of the sales manager of one of the two radio stations that was existing here in Trinidad and Tobago at that time. And he linked me up, as we normally say now. He got in touch with his cousin, and we started talking, and so I got into radio and began hosting my own radio program from 1975. Interestingly enough, my very first radio program on national radio focused on the blind and visually impaired, when we were celebrating what we know in Trinidad and Tobago as Founders Day, May 18th, significantly because it was the day that work for the blind started in Trinidad and Tobago, and by extension, the Caribbean in 1914. So May 18th is a significant day in the lives of blind and visually impaired persons, not just in Trinidad and Tobago, but throughout the region. After that, I went on to doing so many other things. Worked at the Association for the Blind at one time, in the handicraft section, learning the different handicraft skills, etc. But apart from that, I was also involved in groups and organizations, you know, of and for the blind, as well as extending I think to 1985 or thereabouts, when I became a foundation member of the Trinidad and Tobago chapter of Disabled Peoples International. In 1995, we established PAVI, which persons associated with visual impairment, and I am the president of that organization at this time. I served in other capacities, in addition to which I also served on the Caribbean Council for the Blind, of which PAVI is an affiliate member, Caribbean Council for the Blind being the umbrella organization of blindness organizations in the region. And that apart, I'm also involved in the Consortium of Disability Organizations, which is the local umbrella organizations for persons with disabilities. I also got involved in a sport. I always loved cricket, which is a game not too familiar with you Americans, but it's a game that we play well in the West Indies. And in 2005, we established the West Indies Cricket Council for the Blind. I served as the interim secretary, and then when we were formally launched as a secretary till 2014, and thereafter I served as the administrator for the regional board up until the present time. I also am involved in the World Black Cricket Council, which is you know, the umbrella body for black cricket around the world, whether it be Pakistan, India, England, you know, these countries, and the West Indies, of course. And I am currently the first vice president of that organization. My broadcasting fields also took me to the Caribbean News Agency in Barbados, where I was a reporter. And even to this day, I do a number of radio programs. And I started some Facebook activities as well. So that, in a nutshell, is who I am and what I'm about.
Oh my goodness. Let me ask you one important question. When do you sleep? Do you get to sleep much?
Of course. You see, you pattern yourself 8 hours work, 8 hours rest, and 8 hours sleep. So you tend to mix everything, you know?
It sounds like you're doing so much good. What is your favorite thing that you've done in the past. And then I want you to tell me about what you're doing now, more specifically, how you're helping people as president of those people for the visually impaired. What has been your favorite job in the past since 1974? It sounds like the radio host was pretty cool.
Broadcasting, traveling.
You like to travel?
Yeah, well, I have had to travel extensively. So it's not, you know, and broadcasting, of course. I get a chance when I travel to meet some of the great celebrities of particularly cricket and, you know, other celebrities around the world. So I've been in touch with a lot of people throughout the world.
That's amazing. So you do travel by airplane and maybe boats to the other islands as well?
Yeah. I've been more or less up and down the Caribbean to England, Canada, the United States, India, Pakistan, Dubai.
How do you find traveling as a blind person? What has been most helpful to you? Do you have a guide dog?
No. Well, in the Caribbean, in most of the countries, we don't really have guide dogs. One or two people have it, yes, but I prefer to use my cane because it's more flexible and it's less expensive to maintain, because I'm sure people with guide dogs will understand what I'm talking about.
Right, exactly. And do you travel with somebody or do you travel alone?
Well, sometimes I travel alone and I'm met at the airport. Sometimes, well, when my wife was around, she passed away in 2018, we traveled a lot together.
Oh, I'm so sorry.
You know, so that be that as it may, whenever I travel, you know, there are people who look after your interest and show you around. And once you've got that mobility, it helps a lot because you could pass in a certain area one time and you get the feel of the area, you get the feel of the place. It's descriptive and all of that. So you understand where you're traveling to and how you're getting from point A to point B.
Well, I'm so sorry to hear about your wife's passing. It hasn't been that long.
In fact, yesterday was 3 years, and you know, I mean, she was. But interestingly enough, she was physically challenged, and I was totally blind. Well, I'm totally blind, and we always use the remark that I would be her feet, and she would be my eyes.
That's a good way to look at it. You had a good attitude. So, when you travel, sir, I'm just curious: why are you traveling? What are you doing when you get to those other destinations? Are you a public speaker, or are you going to different radio stations?
I'm going to different meetings, different forums, different seminars. I might be called to give some speeches, etc., etc. And of course, with cricket, well, I travel because I'm the administrator and I have to do a lot of work with the cricket, the organizing of the cricket, even broadcasting, even sending back media reports to the Caribbean and so on. So those are the activities I get involved in.
That sounds like fun, the cricket. I was speaking to another gentleman that came on our show. He was doing baseball for the blind. But this is cricket for the blind. Are all the people participating blind, or you have some visually impaired members as well?
It is mixed. Cricket has, like most blind sports or sports for blind persons, there are three categories of persons. They are the totally blind, who refers to in cricketing terms as B1, those with a little vision who may not see enough to move around, we refer to them as B2. And those with sufficient vision, you know, acuity and stuff like that, that they are referred to as B3. But they are not supposed to see to do things like driving. And although you could argue that, but, you know, it depends on your degree of sight that you are categorized. And the ball has beads in it. So and the bowling is on the arm. So, well, ball comes along the ground rather than up in the air most.
Oh, I see. Interesting. And it has a stick, right? You just move it around with a stick?
No. You bowl it as like normal. You throw it from the back of from the hand and it goes to the other wicket where the batsman is positioning himself to play a shot, whether it's a sweep shot or what. And once it connects effectively, you know, it goes and you get runs from it. It just runs are like baseball runs, but there are some similarities, there are some differences. But we try to keep the game as international as possible because we follow many of the rules of what we call conventional play by the people who are quote unquote normal. So it's just some modifications to allow blind persons to play the game effectively. And in fact, sports for the blind is getting bigger and better because they even have blind football or blind rugby. And so blind persons basically are making themselves known and be able to participate in several sporting activities, even at the Special Olympics or Paralympics that's coming up. We have some blind persons from around the world who will be part of those initiatives as well. So sports for the blind is very healthy. And I could advise Alan, because every time you hear Alan, Alan says he eats, he looks like he wants to eat everything. But remember, with eating, you also have to exercise. Exercise to a great degree, my brother.
Thank you.
Definitely have impact. I spoke with another gentleman who was saying a lot of people that are blind, they just get depressed. They want to sit on the couch. You know, they eat too much and they're not moving enough. So this is definitely, you saying that the sports for the blind and visually impaired is growing is really music to everybody's ears. It really is.
Well, before cricket was formally introduced, a lot of us played cards, we played dominoes, we played drafts, because I mean, there are games that are adapted for blind persons to use. So we're not left out of the circle, but with physical sports like cricket, like football, like rugby, you know, it tends to exercise the muscles and so on and so forth.
So you must be in good shape. We're pretty close in age when you were born.
I would be honest. I did not play cricket professionally, because since the cricket was introduced, I got into the administrative role. But when I was at school and, you know, I practiced with the guys and girls. And one of the good things about cricket in most countries is unisex. Men and women play together and some of them stay together. Don't say I say that.
Okay. That sounds like a good thing to bring your relationship closer together, doing something like that together.
And I want to challenge people in America. We want to establish a blind cricket team in any state in America that is willing to accommodate us, because we want to spread cricket. We are not just cricket for the West Indies or for the world, but we are also inclusive of all other nations, even those who don't play cricket.
That's excellent. Thank you so much for sharing that. You know, I noticed that you were on a lot of subcommittees. Committees, if you could tell us a few of the committees that you were on for the blind.
Well, not just for the blind, but these days I'm kind of taking a low profile. You know, when you're going to retirement, you don't want to be too hectic. And I think COVID has put a brakes on how you go out or where you go out. I mean, we can use Zoom and all these technologies now, but I'm not in so many subcommittees again. What I do is focus on, you know, being president of PAVI, vice president of the consortium and stuff like that. You know, I was at one time involved in national committees here in Trinidad, like, for example, Interministerial Committee on Work for the UN Convention on the Rights. And then I was part of the Waterfront Development Project in South Trinidad, where they were trying to include all categories of persons, including persons with disabilities, because they wanted to make the facility as user-friendly as possible for all persons and not and as according to the saying, leave no one behind. So
exactly. You know? So you're inclusive and you want to include everybody.
We want to be as inclusive as possible.
Yes. So what are you doing actually now? Give us some examples of how you help people and what you're doing right now.
Well, right now I am as president of PAVI. It is not a paid job, but it looks like a full-time job sometimes. You know, all voluntary work is full-time, whether we want to agree or not.
Exactly.
Other than that, I am still involved in a number of organizations. As I said, I'm a member of the executive of the Caribbean Council for the Blind. I am involved in World Blind Cricket. I am, you know, involved in local organizations. And basically, I try to keep busy with all kinds of activities internally. You know, being on the phone now is a thing. I'm not a liver on these things. I just use it when I have to. And you know, keeping the communication lines, the lines of communication open, etc. And I see we have people joining us all from St. Lucia. So I told you all that we're going to have a regional participation this afternoon. So, you know, we're trying to make the things happen for people around the globe, so to speak.
You seem like the type of person that likes in-person contact.
Yes, yes.
And how many blind people, you know, just give us a ballpark. Are there a lot of blind people in Trinidad and Tobago or the islands?
Okay. Let me say most Caribbean territories suffer from statistical failure. We don't have enough statistics. However, We, as when we were growing up, we were taught that 10% of your country are persons with disability. And 10% of that 10% are persons with a specific type of disability. Here in Trinidad and Tobago, to use the rough figures, we have 1.4 million people. So if you look at that, you would say that you have about 140 persons with disabilities, and you may have 14,000 blind and visually impaired persons, technically, so to speak.
That's a lot. I think that's a lot, really. 14,000 is quite a bit.
Well, I mean, when you consider countries like India and those other places with millions, you know,
but you know, there's only so many people, the 20% that are doing 80% of the work.
Right. That is the problem with it too. That we find few workers and many persons just on the sideline. We want everybody to come on board, all hands on deck, so to speak.
Right.
This does work with the disabled or the blind in particular does not belong to a few. It belongs to all of us. We need to put our shoulders to the wheel as a group.
Yes. I like your spirit and your attitude. You're amazing. And it's so good to have you on the show. I did want to ask you too. Do you have one child?
Yes, I have a son. He lives in the United States. He's already 26, so you know.
Oh, where does he live?
He's in Maryland currently. He's, supervisor at a pharmaceutical company. He hopes to come to Trinidad as soon as it will be allowed, maybe this year or next year for sure.
Okay. Where was he born?
Born here in Trinidad.
Okay, and you were born there as well?
Of course.
I like your accent. Okay, well, is there anything you could add? I'm sure I left a lot out. You have such an extensive bio. It's just amazing. I'm impressed with your energy and everything you're involved in. You're the type of person that we need in this world.
You want to import me? You want to import me to America?
Oh, wow. I don't want you to.
In fact, let me see here that we have a lot of Trinidadians and West Indians who are blind and visually impaired living in America, and they are making a name for themselves. So, you know, it's not a problem. But in terms of how we go forward, I always say, even for those who get blind as adults, there is life after blindness. And my motto is, it's better you try and fail than fail to try. No matter who you are, what stage of life you are, you know, it's better to know that you've tried something and have failed. You could bounce back, you could try again. I always say I might be knocked out, but not knocked down. So I get up, dust myself off, and move again.
That's wonderful. Gosh, wonderful attitude for sure. I love it. Thank you so much for being here with us today. I hope you come back on the show again.
Let me give credit. I love to give credit where credit is due.
Sure.
To my good friend Alinda Brathwaite in Barbados, she introduced me to this show, and it is from her that I have taken off and said, look, let's do a show in Trinidad, and I hope you all, as the producers, presenters, will consider going up and down the Caribbean, because as a Caribbean people, we have different dishes, we have different cultures, we have different tastes, but one thing is for sure, we have warmth in the Caribbean.
Yes, double warmth between the sun and the people. You can't go wrong, right?
No.
That's wonderful. Thanks again so much. And I want you definitely to come back and keep up the good work of what you're doing. Keep us posted, tell Renee what's going on, and we'll keep in touch, okay?
Sure, will do.
Thank you so much. Okay, sir, thank you for joining us.
Great.
Wonderful.
All right, and I'd like to also thank Thora and Neil, along with our show, to showed us how to prepare some amazingly delicious food from Trinidad and Tobago. And I'd also like to thank all of our virtual audience. You're why we do this show. For joining us today and taking a taste tour of Trinidad and Tobago. You can find today's recipes on our website at www.cookingwithoutlookingtv.wordpress.com, and check out all of our Cooking Without Looking TV shows on our Cooking Without Looking YouTube channel. And you can listen to Cooking Without Looking podcast anywhere you listen to your favorite podcast. And if you wish to personally reach out to Renee or any of us, by phone, you can call 305-200-9104. We're cooking without looking, changing the way we see blindness. Thank you.